Good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to be here to share some insights with all of you. And I will be co-presenting with Liu Xing from Kuaishou. And our topic is all about migrating large-scale Redis instance from bare metal to Kubernetes to improve the resource utilization. And I will start the first part, and Liu Xing can have a rest in the audience. First, about me. I used to be one of the tech leaders of the PolyDBX database team at Alibaba Cloud. The PolyDBX was open sourced back in 2020. And I was one of the maintainers of this project. Because of the work I did in this project, I was honored as the Alibaba Open Source Pioneer of the Year at 2021. And currently, I'm the R&D director at Ape Cloud, and also a maintainer of the Kubeblocks project. Here's today's agenda. First, I will give a brief introduction to Kubeblocks, and then from a single Redis cluster's perspective, I will share three problems that Kubeblocks has solved to make run databases like Redis on Kubernetes better. And then Yu Xing will share some of his experiences about managing multiple Redis clusters across multiple Kubernetes clusters. And finally, the question and answer part. So what is Kubeblocks? We are a startup. Most of us came from the Alibaba Cloud database team. That means we have a lot of experience in both database development and operations. About 2 years ago, we decided to start our own company. We focused on build products that make it easier to run databases on Kubernetes. And last year, we open sourced the Kubeblocks project. In simple terms, Kubeblocks is a Kubernetes operator. But unlike the other database operators, Kubeblocks is designed to support many kinds of databases. In fact, it has supported 35 databases. To achieve these goals, we have structured the Kubeblocks APIs, or CRDs, into two main categories. The first is add-on provider API. By using these APIs, the database provider can easily integrate their databases into the Kubeblocks ecosystem. And the second category is developer and DevOps API. By using these APIs, the users and the operators of the databases can have the ability to manage databases, such as creating a new database cluster, scale up or down, doing backups or restores, and so on. Kubeblocks also introduces a command line tool called kubcli that lets you do all this stuff right from the terminal. And through the declarative APIs, Kubeblocks can be easily integrated with other tools or systems in the Kubernetes ecosystem, such as kubectl, Argo CD, and Terraform, and more. After having a high-level understanding of what is Kubeblocks, let's dive into how it specifically solves problems about about running database on Kubernetes. We all know that running databases on Kubernetes can be quite challenging. One fundamental issue that needs to be resolved is how to handle data replication. For example, in the picture on the left, the system is using a single instance of the Redis database. The single Redis instance is running in a slow set with a single replica. This setup has a few problems. First, this is obviously a single point of failure. It's highly vulnerable to outages. Second, the throughput of the single Redis instance is inherently limited. And third, the risk of data loss is extremely high. To solve these problems, we can scale out the setup set horizontally from a single replica to three replicas. But this introduces a new set of problems that about managing the replication relationships between these replicas. The first problem is, we all know that in a Redis master slave architecture, only the master instance can handle writes. How to ensure the service can find the master instance? The second problem is how the new instances added during scaling can discover the master instance, to properly establish the replication relationships. And the third problem is how to design and update strategies that minimizes the downtime when we need to do minor version upgrades across Redis cluster. So we can see that the stiff set does not really solve these problems quite well. So in Kubeblocks, we introduce a new workload API that specifically designed for databases. We call the instance set. Like the stateful set, the instance set will assign a stable Unicode network identifier to each pod. But one of the key differences that the pods in the instance set are not independent. They have assigned roles that represent the role it plays in the replication relationship. Here is how it works. When the instance set creates each pod, it injects a set car called the KB agent. The KB agent will periodically probe the main database container to detect the current role of it. It then updates a label on the pod to reflect this role. By having this role label, we can do a lot of useful features. First, we can update the service selector to match the master role label. Then the network traffic can go to the master Redis instance automatically. Second, when scaling out the Redis clusters, the new slave instance can find the master instance through this role label and properly establish the replication relationship. And third, having this role label allows us to define better update strategies. For example, following best practice of database upgrades, we can first upgrade the slave Redis instances and then the master instance. Before upgrading the master instance, we can do a switchover operation. Through this role-based design, we can significantly improve the availability of the whole Redis cluster. Speaking of availability, let's talk about the second key topic, how to achieve high availability. Database high availability involves many dimensions. Here we'll focus on the control plane perspective. In addition to the role-based update strategies, the instance set introduces other two features that are related to high availability. The first one is called implicit instance updates. There's a lot of discussions about instance updates of pods and the volume resizing of PVCs in Kubernetes. The instance set also leverages these abilities. But more importantly, the databases has a lot of configuration parameters that often need to be changed. Restarting database every time after a change can significantly impact the availability of the whole database cluster. So instead, the incident set introduces the concept of implicit configure update. We divided the database parameters into three types, that is immutable, static, and dynamic. Immutable parameters cannot be changed once set, and a dynamic parameter can be changed, but need a database restart. And dynamic parameters can be hot reloaded. Based on this, the instance set can perform config updates without a full database restart. And this helps to further improve the availability of the database and improve the RTO, of course. The second feature is called instance rebuild. We all know that there are many databases still run on local PV. In such cases, once a node fails, the pods running on it cannot be rescheduled. Instance rebuild can automatically rebuild these PVs or pods on other nodes, allowing the Redis cluster recover to normal state. After discussing the availability, let's move on to the final part. That is the operator P10K problem. In our use case at Kuaishou, we have an extremely challenging scenario where a single Redis cluster can contain close to 10,000 pods. That means a single instance SCR would have over 10,000 secondary objects. This gives a huge impact on the instance controller reconciliation process. So we have made some parameter tunings and design changes to the instance controller. First, on the tuning side, we have increased the CPU and the memory resources allocated to the instance controller part. Then it can catch more objects. We also increased the rate limiting threshold between the controller and the API server, that is client QPS and client burst. We compressed some of the larger fields of the instance set CR to keep it within the Kubernetes object set limits. We increased the reconciliation go routines from a single one to multiple. On the design side, we split the instance set reconciliation process into two phases, that is prepare and commit. In the prepare phase, we calculate which secondary objects need to be created, updated, or deleted by comparing the desired state in the instance set CR to the current state of the secondary objects. In the commit phase, we submit all these changes to the API server at once. This helps to merge the subsequent reconciliations into one and reduce the total number of reconciliations. Secondly, in the prepare phase, we adopted the idea of functional programming. We design each reconciliation step as a deterministic function. And in the commit phase, we ensure the idempotency of all the requests to the API server. This helps us to solve some problems related to stale cache. And thirdly, we've asynchronized some of the heavier operations in the prepare phase to further improve the reconciliation efficiency. With these optimizations, we are able to handle the P10K problems quite well. Finally, let me summarize what we have covered. Through the rule-based features, we are able to handle the replication relationships of the databases. And we also leverage the in-place instance update and instance rebuild to further improve the availability of the whole Redis cluster. And we have also optimized for the PTNK problems to handle the extreme scenarios that a single Redis cluster with a massive parse. OK, that's it. I'd like to invite Yuxing to the stage.
OK, thank you very much for Xuxing's sharing. Now, I will show you how we use Google Blocks to run multi-Redis instance on multi-Kubernetes clusters. First, please allow me to do a self-introduction. My name is Yuxing Liu, and I have worked at Alibaba Cloud. I'm also one of the maintainers of the open source CNCF Dragonfly and Sailor. Currently, I'm mainly focused on the cloud native transformation of database business for Kuaishou. Before diving into the details, let me provide some background information. The Redis of Kuaishou follows a classic master-slave architecture with three components: server, sentinel, and proxy. I believe that you must be familiar with that. Extremely large scale is one of the key features for the Redis of Kuaishou, not only for the total instance count, but also for the size of a single cluster, which can exceed 10,000. Given that we have already running stable with such a large scale, why would we want to make it cloud native? As for the Redis of Kuaishou, we found that the resource utilization is not high. With such a large scale, even a small change will bring huge benefits. So, what are the typical ways to improve resource utilization? Maybe you have some ideas. Yes. We will find that the cloud native technology has already provided the best practice. Moreover, cloud native has become the new instance between the business and the infrastructure. Well, the stateless service of Kuaishou has already been migrated to container cloud largely. From a long-term perspective, the unification of the infrastructure is an inevitable trend. This not only decouples the business from the infrastructure, but also improves business agility and reduces the operational cost and of the infrastructure. In summary, we decided to do the cloud native transformation is to achieve cost optimization. To better to do this, we involve both the Redis team and the cloud native team. In fact, by being here today, it has already indicated that we have did it with Google Blocks. And then I'd like to discuss with you why we choose Google Blocks. One word summary. The Google Blocks provides API that are more oriented towards stateful services. Let's talk about with this. What are stateful services, and what's the differences between stateful and stateless services? Based on the name, it seems like the differences is whether or not to contain the state info. However, we don't think so. We think the true difference is the unequal relationship between instances. It's just because the different instances play different roles and store different data, so we cannot discard any instance randomly. Additionally, this unequal relationship is not static, and it's very likely to have a change during the runtime, such as when a switchover happens. So the core blocks is designed to solve it. And it provides role-based management capabilities. And it supports multi-database services with just the only one core blocks operator, so that you don't need to implement a dedicated operator for each database. Additionally, there is a very interesting point is that the core blocks provides process-oriented APIs through the ops request object. And it makes the migration of database be easier. If you are interested, you can learn more details by official documents. We have talked about the core blocks API. So how exactly does the core blocks define the Redis cluster? Firstly, it should contain all the components, such server, sentinel, and proxy. To reduce the duplicated definition of components, core blocks takes the component definition and component version independently, so they can be referenced when creating a new cluster. Let's use the Redis server as an example, which is the most complex component. Firstly, the Redis server is defined using a shard spec. A shard spec contains a list of shards. The reason we do this is that to support larger scale data. For a Redis server cluster, it needs to be split into multi shards, and each shard has a master and a slave instance. Another key point is that the master and the slave instance within a shard may have different configurations. To handle this, the core blocks allows you to define the different configurations within the same team by using the instance template. So the Redis server component, we will see that the object relationships are divided into the following layers. Cluster, shard spec, component, instance template, and then the instance is a final workload which is auto-generated, and it provides the role-based management capabilities we mentioned before. As for the role-based management capabilities, we will summarize as 2 points. The first one is how to build and maintain the correct role relationships. And the second one is how to implement role-based management. Xue Qiang has introduced to us before. So let's focus on the how to maintain the correct role relationships. That's a very important thing that we need to pay attention. We believe that the master information for a shard is very important. If an error occurs or it cannot be obtained, it will lead to serious problems. Therefore, in order to ensure the stability of the business, we prefer to split the data plan and the control plan here. That's the reason why we don't use the core blocks to get the master information. Okay, we have seen that the core blocks has done a great job for running stateful services within a single Kubernetes cluster. However, as mentioned before, the number of Redis of cluster is very large, which is far exceeds the capacity of a single Kubernetes cluster. So we have to use multi-Kubernetes clusters to support it. Regarding the management of multi-classes, if we make the Redis team to be aware of multi-classes, it will bring several problems. The Redis team needs to maintain the buffer resource pool for all Kubernetes clusters, which means more wasted resource. and the Redis team have to migrate the Redis cluster in advance before a single Kubernetes cluster reaches its limit. So we think it's better to hide the complexity for a multi-cluster. Fortunately, we have already provided the needed capability through the federated cluster in Kuaishou. Unfortunately, Kubeblocks itself doesn't support multi-clusters. How do we solve it? And we can see this architecture feature. We split the Kubeblocks operator into two paths. The cluster operator and the component operator are placed in the fragmented cluster, where the instance set controller is implicit in the member cluster. In the middle, there is a component named federated instance set controller, which is used to distribute the instance set object from the federated cluster to the member clusters. So, how does it actually work? The first key points here. The first responsibility is to get a scheduling recommendations, and it will know how many instances should be deployed for each member cluster. And the second main job is to split the instance set to multi sub instances and distribute them to the member clusters. Just like the sleeper sets, the instance sets also have numbered names for instance. To make sure we don't break this rule, we redesign the ordinals field for the instance set. It allows custom the number range. Okay, with this architecture, we are able to support the Kubeblocks work with multi-Kubernetes cluster and without major changes. In addition to meeting the business requirements in terms of functionality, we also need to make sure the solution could reach production level, especially for stability guarantee. Let's discuss a few points here. First, on the scheduling capability, in order to ensure the high availability of Redis, we should ensure that instances are as dispersed as possible. But we also should consider the impact of a single machine failure on the Redis cluster size. So we have customized a fingering the dispersion scheduling capability to both support configure the max number instance for each node and the max number node for each Redis cluster. We also provide the load balanced scheduling capabilities based on CPU, memory, and network bandwidth, and so on. Then, let's take a look at the runtime control. We all like the automation brought by Kubernetes, but it also means greater risks. A small change may lead to a large scale failure. Therefore, we have done a lot of control over the running instance, such as concurrency management and control, and we just allow in place updates and so on. And there are so many works as well. Because of the time limit, I will not list them one by one here. If you are interested, you are welcome to discuss with me later. Okay, let's do a simple summary. I believe that everyone has realized that the Kubeblocks is an excellent project. Compared to the stateful set, Kubeblocks has designed a new API for stateful service and provide role-based management. And it makes it easier to implement the cloud native transformation. it seems like the Kubernetes API can support almost all stateful services. Here, however, I think that there are still some work need to be done. The first one is how to build connections with the existing database operator and align with their capabilities. Secondly, we should try to promote the construction of the standard API for stateful services. And the question is also willing to work on this area together with Kubeblocks. In fact, yesterday, Kuaishou has collaborated with Kubeblocks in many capabilities. Okay, that's all. Thank you. If you have any questions, you can ask us. Both Chinese or English is okay.
Okay. Currently, they are always in the same member cluster.
But why? Might go down, like, and you lose like all replicas.
That's a good point, very good point. We are working on to solve it, but currently, they are running the same member clusters. And because we did that on the current design of the instance, the Kubeblocks and our business need at Kuaishou. So we first, we should first move our business to running on Kubernetes and solve some further problems, such as the problem you mentioned here.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. 大家中文、英文提问都可以啊。
在快手这边的话，其实Redis 其实除了内存之外，还有那个 RDB 的那个备份的存储，这个也是有的。这个我们其实是目前是通过 LocalPP 做的。这个一方面也是去复用了它的那个原地更新，就是保持原地的那个能力。对。就是
Redis 如果内存占用比较高，然后这边大概至少有三份，那它的这个 cost 是不是会高一些？是指
memory 的 cost？
就是有一些程序，比如放在 Redis 上面，然后占用了很大的内存，然后这时候我现在看到有一个 master， 两个 slave 嘛，就相当于是，有三份这样的内存占用。
对，就是，首先 Redis 本身它是支持主备量的架构的，然后主备之间它数据是保持实时的一个同步，也就意味着它的主和备之间数据是完全一样的，它们就会消耗同样的那个资源。对，然后，但它其实是以空间来换它的高可用嘛，如果其实你跑一个单的副本，只有一个 master 也是能运的，运行的，那就是刚才那个图里面会提到会有一个单点的故障的风险，然后可能也会数据丢失，反而会有一些问题。 所以就这首先要决策的是在架构选型的时候，你是要用主备来获得高可用，然后但是会牺牲一些资源额外的开销，还是说我那个资源的消耗是我第一个优先级要考虑的，是吧？我可以牺牲一些我系统的高可用性，它其实是个架构的选择。在快手这边显然是优先选的那个高可用。
所以如果对于空间占用比较大的，比如有一个 T 的这种 PostgreSQL。
那同样的也是三份，所以其实这个道理就一样的，就是空间占用也会很大，对，但是换来的就是高可用嘛。，PG 的话是，又是稍微有些不同，就 Redis 它本身大部分的数据其实是在内存的，这也是它为什么能够做一个缓存这样的一个组件的一个原因嘛。
对，
但其实 PG 的话，它大部分数据是在磁盘的。
把它更多的是一个磁盘的一个消耗。但如果单纯的说资源这个视角，显然也是的，也是需要两分。对。
哦，理解。
啊，老师，那个我看 P 十这边有一个叫做实例原地更新的一个叫 KB Agent 嘛，就这块、啊、这里面提到了三点嘛，一个是那个Pod 的一个可变和 不可变的，哎，不好意思，这个是不应该不是 P 十，在那个如何实现高可用 HA 那里面，对，这就这一页嘛、
啊。对，
就我对于这三种类型的实现，包括那个 PVC 的一个动态的扩容，还有 Config Map 的一个动态的加载。这几个实现方式能不能帮我们再具体展开一点，这个比较感兴趣。
首先就是这张图里面讲的是说在 Kubernetes 里面有一个一个新的 API 叫做 Instance Set， 是吧，有点像 Stable Set， 但是也有些不同。它主要目标是为数据库这种场景去设计的。然后在这个 API 里面它支持了一个原地更新的这样的一个能力。然后再具体展开的话，它会包括三个维度。第一个维度是 Pod 的原地更新。Pod 原地更新其实就是依赖了 KBase 原生的那个 Pod， 它哪些字段可以更新，那这边就可以直接更新掉。第二个是 PVC 的话，就是 Volume Resizing， 这个其实也是那个 PVC API 所支持的。然后比较特殊的一点是，数据库它其实有非常多的那个参数，还有很多的参数是需要经常去做变更的。然后如果每次变更你把数据库都重启一下，这显然对那个可用性影响是非常大的。所以就是我们会进一步做了一个设计，就是数据库的那个参数配置里面有一部分变更的时候，我们支持它的相当于叫用 KBase 的话叫做原地更新，或者说那个数据库的话叫做热加载这样的一个能力。它首先它其实依赖于具体的某一款数据库引擎它的内核的能力的，它如果支持一些参数的热加载，那么这边才能支持，如果人家不支持其实它也没办法，这是第一个前提。第二个是配置这种信息默认是最终渲染成一个 config map 的，我们会有一个那个渲染参数的一套设计，然后会有一个参数模板，然后会有一些一个约束，说我比如说 Redis 我大概只是100个参数，其中有20个我是可以那个 dynamic 的，有10个是 static 的，剩下那些都是 immutable 的，然后其实是需要在那个配置的约束里面提前写好的，你要给我一个输入，然后这样就是在Kubelock 在处理的时候他就知道啊遇到比如说某次参数变更，那它是属于 dynamic 的 ，OK， 那我就知道我现在通过我的那个 sidecar， 就是 KB agent 的那个 sidecar 去里面触发一个指令，然后让它再进一步去调对应的引擎的那个 reload 的那样的一个指令，它就会把那个参数给加载进来，它大概就是这样的一个过程。
就是说这个 CM 的更新其实并不是更新 Redis 本身的那个它的声明是配置里面的内容，是更新的编程里面的相关的一些 config map 的信息嘛？因为我理解 CM 可能原生的话本来就是不可变的，或者说你要更新等于是要动整个声明，这块我就不太理解。
CM 的话应该是可变的，只不过就是它更新之后加载到 pod 里面可能时间并不那么受控，是吧，有时候可能会很快，
更新周期，对
对，有时候可能会很慢，所以我们的做法其实是咋说呢，我会尝试去 patch 那个，及时的去 patch 那个 config map， 然后以保证我的配置能够及时的加载到本地，这是第一点。第二点的话，我会做那个更新的时候是完全按照就是上层可配置的一个更新的策略，比如说你是应该是一个灰度的过程，然后也是一批批在做的，那我相当于就会一批批的按照你灰度的策略去调用对应的那个 pod 上面的 kb agent 来触发它那个配置的 reload 的这样的一个指令，就这样按照一个更新的策略去受控的去做这样的一个过程。
好，谢谢。
OK。
如果一个 site 的 wet discuster 整个 site 死掉，有没有 solution 把 data 都拷贝到另外一个 site 的 wet discuster？
其实这个问题相对来说应该要提前的去在稳定性做一些事情的，相对来说，譬如说你之前在一开始你就要去做一些你的跨城的一些容灾，或者说跨 AZ 的一些容灾。那有了这样的一些容灾之后呢，相对来说，譬如说你一个机房挂掉，那其实并不会影响到你另外一个机房，这时候对你来说就是一个切流的一个事情了，对。
any question? 还有问题吗 ？OK OK。
问个小问题，就刚那个就是从 label 去标识自己是什么 role， 对吧？
对。
那个逻辑是说 KB agent 自己检测，然后 KB agent 有那个权限去给那 pod 加那个 label。
对，这是一个非常好的问题，因为时间有限，其实我没有展开去讲。你会发现在这部，有些小字，他说的就是 KB agent 把那个决策探测到了，他总得有一种方式，最终把它体现为 pod 的一个 label， 是吧？我们叫做角色 label， 这是一个比较漫长的过程。在默认的情况下，我们用一个 KBS 的事件，就是 KB agent 会发一个 KBS 的事件，然后
有个人
对，然后 incident controller 它会 watch 这样的事件，
okay.
去解析出那个角色，然后去更新 pod， 这是一种。但其实 KBS 的那个事件是不可靠的，是吧？有时候会延迟，有时候可能会丢，但是角色这个信息对数据库来说是至关重要的，所以我们会额外提供其他一些机制，说你 OK。默认的这种方式觉得不靠谱，你可以把一个更可靠的，比如说类似于一个事件中心这样的一个组件，比如说一个消息队列引入进来到系统里面，把决策信息发到消息队列里面，然后 incident controller 去订阅那个消息的队列，然后达到决策信息，拿到决策信息之后去更新到这个 pod label 上面。所以反正、就是、
但你最终还是作用在那个 label 上是吧？
对，最终它是体现了一个 pod 的 label，然后这个 label 反正就是根据它里面跑的那个 DB 的进程，它所扮演的角色去做一个实时的更新，只不过它是它有个有一定的延迟嘛。
OK OK，所以那个 KB agent 的应该是那个数据库 specific 的实现是吧？因为它要探它到底是不是 master、是吧？
这是非常好的一个问题，因为其实在一开始我讲的就是 KB 它本身是要就 Kubelux 是要支持很多种的数据库的，是每一种数据库它决策探测方式是不一样的，所以其实 KB agent 它会设计成一种就这里提到的一个通用的就 general role prop framework， 它里面首先是有一个决策探测的框架，它简单来说就是会周期性的去触发探测这个动作，然后有了决策的信息之后再发事件，这是他做的。然后他不做的部分是，或者说需要去每为每个引擎需要去注入的是那个具体探测的那个 action
方法的脚本是吧？
对，你可以给我一个脚本，可以给我一个镜像，再加上里面的指令或者怎么着，你给我，然后我去周期性的去调它，然后把你的返回结果，我就认为那就是那个 role， 不管你叫是 leader 还是 master， leader 还是叫 master 还是叫 primary，
可能 okay,
okay. 对我会把它原模原样贴到那个 pod label 上面。
理解理解。哦，最后一个问题就是那个，可能问一下快手的同学，就是，因为刚这个里面就是很大一件事情是在说那个scaling 嘛 ，auto scaling， 就整个那个数据库，不管是 master server 结构在 scaling。但我刚看你们那 best practice 里面，在那个10K 那个环境下面，有 fine grained scheduling， 以至于就是说某个集群里有多少 node， 某个 node 上有多少个 instance。那个都已经排布好了，如果要是那样一个严格的一个装箱排布的话，这个在这个环境下面 scaling 会经常发生吗？还是说其实就是一次性调度好就好了？
理论上来说，这里面我们会首先第一次调度的时候，我们确实是会从联邦这边然后去拿到那个 scheduling， 然后后续的话我们只有扩容的调度，就相当于新增实力的调度，而对于已有的实力，我们是这里会有，刚刚我们讲到这里我们有 runtime control， 这个 control 我们会保证几乎所有实力全部是 in place update， 我们不会让它去发生重建重新调度这个事情，除非是这个机器然后除非是这个实力出现这个机器当掉，或者说这个实力无法恢复了。那这时候呢，其实前面学强也讲到，就是我们其实是具备一个指定实力缩容的一个能力，那就是我们就会指定把这个实力缩掉，然后我们就会再去扩新的实力。对，
嗯，然后那个你要是那个扩容的时候，也是按照那个我们叫 scheduling planning， 或者
就是扩容
小来扩是吧？
对对对 ，yes， 就扩容和新建其实走的都是同样的创建 pod 的流程。对对对对
，OK， 好，谢谢。
Time stop， 我们时间到了，所以还有其他问题，我们可以线下交流。
OK，Thank
you，Thank you，
感谢大家，感谢大家 ，Thank you。